Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. Today, we return to the Lilli Palmer Acteurist Oeuvre-view. It's our second episode on Lilli. We'll be talking about Command, Performance, and Crackerjack. I think we can get right into it, although I did promise everyone a report on the autobiography, Change Lobsters and Dance. She actually talks shockingly little about any films. Nothing of substance really was said about any of these British movies. She did refer to Crime Unlimited because it was the first one. It's a really good book. I heartily recommend it. It offers more insight into her personal journey than into the films that she was making and the people that she knew, of course. There's a lot about Rex Harrison, so once we start getting into the movies that she made with him, I imagine I will bring in some of the material. No mention of Secret Agent. Last week we theorized that of course she would have to talk about Hitchcock if she worked with him, but no mention. The main insight that I get about how she envisioned her career progressing in these early films in the 1930s before Rex Harrison, she was still very much looking to master film acting technique. She talks a lot about how she was hoping that dyeing her hair blonde would give her a shortcut to superstardom. She laments the state of her face early on, thinks she was too heavy. She was still getting used to film as a medium, peroxide, and trying to bring out more and more of her cheekbones was her main goal. Of course, she does talk a lot about it wasn't just her idea. This was something that cameramen were constantly saying to her. Everyone was saying, you gotta keep losing a few more pounds there.
Well, it sounds like Marlene Dietrich's journey, but she took her sweet time losing that weight. The first few Sternberg films are pretty plump.
Yeah, I think she looks great. I think Lilli looks great in these movies too. I don't share her low opinion of her appearance in these movies.
All I remember is reading that Dietrich went on a diet of saltines only. Of course, there's always the stories about these actresses getting their molars pulled to enhance the cheekbones. Lilli, despite having a round face, already has plenty of cheekbones.
Yeah, but she's gonna get even more. Couldn't have helped that Noel Coward called Marlene Dietrich and Lilli Palmer his two Prussian cows.
Well, they seem to love it.
She was a really good friend of Noel Coward, and they appeared on stage together in the last play that he wrote and appeared in, and she had to cue him on his own lines quite a bit.
Sure she enjoyed telling that story.
Sounds like they got through it. There's something for everyone in Change Lobsters and Dance, but not much on Command, Performance, and Crackerjack. In fact, nothing.
I cannot see a great deal of film acting technique on display in these films. She does seem like her star is on the rise because she's being put opposite not conventional leading men, but stars in these films. Playing the love interest. Her role is actually quite substantial in Crackerjack, but not necessarily good.
I really enjoyed both of these movies.
I'm just saying that her roles left something to be desired.
And I think we'll talk about that. They're in the vicinity of standard ingenue roles, I suppose, although they each have their own little variations.
Well, I wouldn't say Crackerjack was at all a standard ingenue role, but it felt like it was the weakest part of the movie.
She's a supporting player anyway. The big star is Tom Walls.
I really enjoyed Crackerjack. Command, Performance was weird. A really weird movie. Occasionally quite effective, but not necessarily in the way I think the movie intends. So the street singer, Dave.
I know of him because as an old-time radio fan, the term comes up. He was a popular tenor of the 1930s. He was American, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is not a British celebrity, but I guess he came across the pond and made some appearances.
Russian Jewish parents. eventually moving to New York, appearing in vaudeville and amateur reviews, where he was seen and offered a 15-minute CBS radio program. Wikipedia says here, to avoid embarrassing his family if his show failed and to prevent being blackballed from future vaudeville bookings for having appeared on radio, Tracy decided to make his identity a mystery and borrowed a billing from the title of Frederick Lonsdale's musical The Street Singer. Listeners demanded to know his identity, but it was not revealed until 5 months after his 1931 debut on CBS.
Not everyone's going to love 1930s tenor singing, but I really enjoy that style.
People who are old like us might recall the Steve Martin early 80s movie Pennies from Heaven. So Arthur Tracy's 1937 recording of Pennies from Heaven was chosen from hundreds of versions for the movie of that name. And the film brought Tracy out of retirement.
Oh good, he was still alive.
At age 82, he returned as a cabaret singer at the Cookery in Greenwich Village in 1982.
That's awesome.
1996, he was granted the Ellis Island Medal of Honor. This was also not his only film.
Well, he was very likable.
Yeah, he has a terrible speaking voice, but I guess everybody knew who he was and knew him from his radio program, and that was fine. It's not a voice you'd imagine a successful leading man to have.
Did he make any movies in Hollywood or only in the UK?
So he was in a pre-code musical, The Big Broadcast.
Oh, okay. Those are kind of yearly extravaganzas.
Right? This was with Bing Crosby, Stuart Irwin, and Lila Himes.
They're like the Paramount equivalent of the Gold Digger series, but not as good.
He was also in something called Flirtation in 1934, but that doesn't seem to have been any kind of lead role. So I'd say this is his first leading role. And then with a different director, he made a 1937 film, The Street Singer. And with the same director as Man Performance, he made Follow Your Star in 1938.
Who's the director? Sinclair Hill?
Yeah.
Here he's basically playing himself or a version of himself.
I can't remember. It doesn't say on Wikipedia. What did they call him in the movie? Did they call him Arthur?
They called him Arthur and they called him The Street Singer.
Yeah.
They never called him Arthur Tracy. So he's an American on a lucrative tour of the British Isles. His agent, Finlay Curry, is great and he's doing kind of an American accent. I mean, he's a British actor. But you could really see in these movies the influence of American films on British cinema of the 1930s. You've got the kind of tough agent talk you'd associate with a Warner Brothers movie.
Sure.
And in Crackerjack, you even have American gangsters. So he is playing himself on the verge of a nervous collapse. This is a storyline that we've seen a fair bit. It's kind of nice that the pop culture purveyors of the time were willing to show that side of a performer's life, that they were overworked and on the edge, maybe taking a lot of speed.
He's not taking speed, so they didn't show that. Part of the plot of the movie that I guess there would have been, in some cases, agent-leaked tabloid stories of this kind. You'd think that agents would be covering it up rather than leaking it, but maybe both approaches were around.
Any kind of notoriety, if you can stir up sympathy even, right? At first he keeps saying, well, okay, I've got to take a break. This command performance in 3 or 4 weeks, let's just leave it at that, because I keep feeling something in my throat. I thought we were going to get, you know, Frank Sinatra throat rupture.
Obviously, we're waiting for something to happen to him on stage.
Pretty tense.
Yeah, so this I found effective. This whole sequence of having him introduced, not just as a singer, but as a personality. The sequence where he actually does lose his voice, or loses the upper range.
In Danny Boy.
I thought that was one of the most effective portrayals I've ever seen of the relationship between a popular performer and, you know, street singer. Obviously, that indicates a certain type of homey, down-to-earth kind of performer, right?
Yeah, he doesn't carry himself like a prima donna. I mean, he signs every single autograph.
He's singing for the most part. Okay, well, I'll give you my whole theory on the movie here.
He's singing very heartwarming tunes, yes.
Heartwarming tunes and schmaltzy tunes and folksy tunes.
Songs that everyone knows. And yes. Of course, that becomes very important in the Danny Boy sequence.
Yes, exactly. So he appeals to the audience instead of this becoming a crisis where he's embarrassed and the audience gets angry because they're not getting their money's worth. He manages to turn it around and appeal to the goodwill goodwill he's earned by being one of them, and yet still a star, ask for their help, right? It's like he and the audience and the song are all made of the same stuff. They're just as happy to sing it to him as he is to sing it to them. And that's just like such a fascinating idea, really turning on its head ideas about performance and the relationship between entertainment and capitalism, you know, and between entertainment and audiences and skill and everything else, right?
It really was quite affecting. I loved it. Again, though, I was still thinking, okay, his vocal cords have ruptured. He's got blood gushing in his throat or something, but it doesn't go that way. It turns out that this is the result of an impending nervous collapse. That's the doctor's diagnosis.
I'll tell you something, Dave. I'll tell you a little story. Although I had no training whatsoever as a singer, in junior high, I got the lead role in the junior high musical, you know, kind of based on personality. I was giving a very emotional rendering of the part and the songs.
What's the musical?
Oh, it's just some awful... It was literally written by a committee of parents.
Oh, okay. Not a recognized...
No.
Classic.
Not at all. But anyway, I had one big show-stopping, heart-rending number, and it was only one performance. What nobody bothered to tell me, and certainly the musical director of this play should have known and did know that I didn't have any training. He certainly had a lot of musical training himself, but didn't bother to warn me that if you get nervous, if you get stage fright, your voice will disappear. And trained singers have workarounds for that. I got up there and nothing came out of my mouth. I had to get through this song with the thinnest possible sound squeaking out of my mouth. It was a nightmare. And then I had to do the whole play.
Well, at least you can take heart from the fact that it's probably not on YouTube.
That's right. Now I would never live that down for the rest of my life.
Well, my main experience with a musical was Oliver! But I landed the role of Bill Sykes, hopefully on merit, but also a nice benefit was that he's the only one who doesn't sing.
Yeah, I would have been happier with a non-singing role, I think. Yes, nerves can affect your voice.
Yeah, so he's got to get out of there. He's fighting tooth and nail to get away from his agent, who really is a scumball.
Familiar plot, faintly reminiscent of Singin' in the Rain, including the fact that we've seen him also in production for a movie where he's dating his co-star, but she's kind of a pain in the ass.
Yeah, he doesn't like her.
But he is going out with her, because it just kind of comes with the territory. So I was going to say, though, I feel like the two performances that bookend the movie, this Danny Boy performance, where he's at one with the audience of regular people, and this command performance given for royalty, where he's singing opera, I feel like these are made to contrast with each other to a certain extent. Putting that out there is my sketch of the movie's structure, but let's not actually talk about what happens until we get there.
He makes good his escape. He has no money. Only tradable good that he has on him is a bag of golf clubs. Turns out to be quite handy, but no wallet, no identification of any kind.
He's doing his very own Sullivan's Travels.
Yeah, a little bit. And he takes to the countryside. He has a few coins in his pocket and he uses that to get on the train. He goes as far as the rails allow and then he gets off. He pals around with a ne'er-do-well poacher.
So his movie is about gypsies, or at least he has a song about them, and his command performance is from Carmen, which is about a gypsy. I'm going to just keep saying gypsies, even though I know you're not supposed to say that anymore, because there's no getting around it in this movie.
The word is everywhere. It's in most of the songs, everyone's saying it, and Lilli Palmer is playing a character who is a traveler, right?
So in the midst of the movie, he also just meets up with some gypsies. No longer just a romantic notion in his art, he's actually living this picaresque life.
Yeah, and it's a very positively portrayed family that we meet. Much more positive on the whole than you get in the movie Flight of the Doves, which we covered at the end of the Dorothy McGuire series. Very benevolent father and two daughters.
The non-gypsy hobo, tramp, he is less positively portrayed.
Yeah, but he has the big redemption arc. And it's an important role. He's the one that really gets to have an entire moral transfiguration.
Fair enough. Mark Daly? as Joe?
He's probably a star of some sort. That's how it comes across, anyway.
All I can tell about him from his Wikipedia page is that he made a lot of movies.
A rural rascal, stealing hens from the rich so that he can roast them on his open fire. He shares with Arthur Tracy, the street singer, although he's traveling incognito. He's not taking too many pains to cover it up. The golf bag does say A.T. on it.
No one seems to know who that is here, to his relief.
They do, though. He seems to be very popular. Everyone all across the UK seems to know the street singer, right? That's why people are listening at the encampment at the end of the movie.
I thought maybe they just were doing that because they had found out about him. Because when Lilli Palmer's character, Susan, hears him sing, well, the voice in the movie, she says, oh, that's you.
Yeah.
But I wasn't sure if she knew who the actor in the movie or singer in the movie was supposed to be.
Well, maybe not her, I'm not sure, because it's kind of an open question how often she gets anywhere near a radio. I don't know.
Exactly. And when he sings in the pub, no one seems to identify him.
Well, they don't identify him, but that's just because you don't expect someone that you hear on the radio to show up at your local pub.
Joe says he could use some lessons.
Yeah. With a little training, you'd be dynamite.
In the pub, we get an even more populist type of singing.
The old bucket. These are clearly big pub songs that everyone would know at the time.
They exchange little known pub songs.
So yeah, you really get into this camaraderie. The friendship develops, but once they meet up with Lilli Palmer, there's some friction because Joe is sweet on Susie, played by Lilli Palmer.
And she's definitely out of his league, even after he washes his face.
Yeah, he's about 30 years too old for her. He's just a no-good tramp.
He's not a singing and movie star.
No. And you've got little Betty. At first I was like, is that Lilli Palmer's daughter or something? But no, they're sisters. She is a big character in the movie.
Yeah, well, this is one of the weird and interesting things about the movie is that maybe befitting the type of character he's playing, at least in this movie, maybe they develop him more as a romantic type in his other movies, but in this movie his romantic relationship is actually with the child, which isn't uncommon for portraying a kind of sentimental entertainer.
Well, it's like all those movies that Shirley Temple was in. You know, sure. She's like a matchmaker. There's some kind of parental figure that she has this deep relationship with that she manages to get an age-appropriate woman for.
But they even share a kiss at the end, and that's the end of the movie, basically. I don't recall there being anything more with Lilli Palmer after he kisses the little girl.
Well, there's the hands. They're clutching each other's hands. That's how the movie ends.
Not the very end.
Yeah, I think so. Focuses in on he's holding her hands, and they're both at Betty's sickbed.
She doesn't get a kiss, though.
No, she doesn't get a kiss. No.
The movie pulls away. I thought the final shots were of the caravans, not of hands.
We'd have to revisit it, but the last we see of Lilli is definitely she's holding hands with the street singer.
Yeah. Still, a movie that ends with kissing a little girl instead of Lilli Palmer has an odd approach to romance.
I would agree.
This is established early on because the little girl basically is Susan's double,
yeah.
Right? And she's just Susan as an open-hearted child, as opposed to the kind of snippy old maid Margaret Sullivan in Shop Around the Corner adult version that we see.
This is very early in Lilli Palmer's career. She's 22 or 23 making this movie. She certainly looks like a very young woman, but she is feisty and defensive, and she may have been dealing with a lot of guys like Joe.
Well, she's actually very nice to Joe when he confesses his crush. She holds his hand.
Well, she is very nice, but still, she's got to do what she can to discourage the wrong kind of attention.
No. That's not what's going on here. It's the right kind of attention that she's discouraging. The reason that she's being so mean to Arthur is because she likes him. She has no idea how to deal with this, it appears.
And especially once she realizes that he's an internationally famous movie star and singer.
Well, that's when relations break down.
Yeah.
But that doesn't happen for quite a while.
You just get the sense that people come and go. She's a traveler. They're on the move. You have to be careful, I would think. Especially someone that you really like. Are they really going to stick around or not? Are you going to be able to go along together or not? That's what I got from it.
This is an impassioned psychological defense of Susan.
Yes. She's right to be careful. She doesn't know anything about this guy. He seems nice. And as you say, Betty just embraces him right away because she's not worried about those things.
But look at what happens to Betty. She ends up nearly dying.
Right. That's where Susie is smart. She knows that it's dangerous to start to care so deeply for someone. You might wind up in the middle of the night in your pajamas trying to run to London and getting hit by a car.
But it's actually Susie who drives him away. But okay, so this is where the structure of the movie comes back. Because once Joe, you know, blows the whistle and lets the movie people know where Arthur is...
This is the real betrayal moment here.
Yeah, and they come and start filming in the neighborhood and looking for quote-unquote gypsy extras. We have a whole pretty funny sequence where his co-star and love interest, Olga, Phyllis Stanley as Olga, she's having a temperamental fit on the director because...
She can't play the scene with an extra.
She can't summon the passion, right?
She needs her actual boyfriend there.
And he's like, it's fine, we're going to play a recording of his voice. She's like, well, okay, maybe I can do it then. But Arthur is eventually seduced into revealing himself, even though he was planning to remain in disguise, because this is where we're leading up to the command performance. Because Arthur, it seems, although he cares nothing for Olga, does care a lot about his professional obligations.
He does.
And so when he sees that she is struggling with this scene, he has to literally enter the picture. Of course, she is ecstatic. She thinks that means everything's back to normal. Professionally and personally, she probably can't tell the difference.
It's probably a wonderful take for the film.
Yeah, absolutely. Who else can't tell the difference?
Lilli Palmer.
Is Susie. Now, despite how harsh she is to him there, I feel like she's actually kind of got a point, because I think Arthur is a bit confused still between the professional and the personal, and we're going to see that play out in the command performance, where the two are put at very stark odds, performing for royalty versus saving a little girl's life, and particularly a little gypsy girl who's outside of society, and Arthur doesn't make the obvious choice. So the command performance, you know, is a really important thing, probably to this day in British history. We might remember, if you're old like us and still have boomer reference points, you might remember John Lennon telling the audience to just rattle their jewelry when the Beatles played for the Queen.
I don't remember that.
You might remember the reference.
Sure.
Not the event.
No, that's before our time.
And that was considered very, very cheeky. And Arthur's not going to get cheeky with royalty.
Well, he's not, but let's not forget, it's not like he can teleport to the encampment. It turns out to be the best thing to commandeer the airwaves to sing to her.
But he doesn't figure that out right away.
No.
At first he's just, well, I can't get there right away, and I really have to sing Carmen to the King.
I was wondering when we were watching it, was that supposed to be Edward, or was it George VI? It's 1937. I always forget exactly when Edward abdicated.
George VI assumed the throne on December 11th, 1936, and was crowned on May 12th, 1937. This was made in August.
Okay, so Edward was already gone. He went off to marry his American divorcee. Didn't look like George VI. In the balcony. They didn't go in for casting lookalikes of royalty, probably, in England at that time.
So we're all sweating while he sings this Toreador song. We're siding with Joe, who's just like, what are you doing? Get back here, we have to go. But then, as he's giving this performance, he comes up with the idea.
I'll sing a song that's meaningful to Betty, and she'll hear me.
Of broadcasting it, but he knows very well that she may not hear him. They have to be listening to the radio.
That's right.
He has no particular reason to think they've even got a radio.
But we don't want to gloss over Joe's journey here, because he was jealous. Susie's being stolen from him. He tries to get rid of the street singer. Then he's still hovering around, and he realizes that while Betty's life and Susie's happiness depend on this tragedy being averted, and the only thing that can avert it, the doctor tells us, is if Arthur comes back to give renewed strength to the critically injured Betty.
So he makes this emotional appeal to royalty after having made an emotional appeal on his own behalf to the common people in his first performance. Luckily, royalty is also understanding, so he gets approval first to sing the song to the sick child and then to go to her.
Yep.
And of course there's all sorts of additional suspense and tension as somebody at the camp decides to turn off the radio because it's bothering the sick child, they think.
Turns into almost a meta discussion about what do you do? Like, what is helpful to someone who is suffering?
Well, not turning off the voice of somebody she dearly loves.
Yeah, but they don't know that.
Exactly.
But does great art help someone who is laid up in bed? I would think probably we're more on the side of it can't hurt now, but it may do nothing. You know, like in Vertigo, Jimmy Stewart just sits there. No matter what Barbara Bel Geddes plays.
Well, maybe he needed the street singer instead of Mozart.
It all comes together very nicely. As melodrama fans, I think we're both okay with the idea that singing can bring someone back from the brink of death, and his return to the camp does even more. She's gonna be fine. Susie can let down some of her defenses now knowing that Arthur is putting them first.
Well, I don't know about first, but he did come back anyway. He did make an effort.
He's not just gonna go off to America and leave them.
No.
They'll get married at least before he returns to his street singer life.
Well, she has to also learn to be more vulnerable.
She does. That could have been a sequel. I like Lilli Palmer in the movie. She doesn't get to show a huge amount of range here.
There are actually quite a lot of acting opportunities, but the movie does seem to be somewhat quickly, cheaply made. I think she's experimenting with a lot of things here.
Developing that film acting technique.
Exactly, but not necessarily being carefully directed in her performance.
No.
Whereas the child really is being carefully directed in her performance.
She was good.
Yeah.
I really liked Betty. I should mention, of course, that there are no Leonard Maltin reviews for these films. They were not to be seen on American home video or TV in 1990. And now let's talk about Crackerjack.
So I was interested to learn that Tom Walls was famous as a farceur.
He was really fun.
He was. He was literally ancient.
Well,
but...
yeah.
But he was nevertheless a great deal of fun. He really carried the picture successfully.
Not age appropriate for Lilli Palmer, but I liked her a lot in this movie too. Yes, as you say, it's not exactly an ingenue role because she's playing a baroness. She has a whole backstory as a secret agent, we find out. She manages to seem older than she is.
I found it totally unbelievable that this character had ever been in the Secret Service.
Well, yeah, sure.
She wasn't acting shrewd enough for that. And I also, again, found that there wasn't enough attention paid to this performance to give the character any kind of arc that made sense in terms of what is her motivation for working against this man that she's in love with.
What you can say is that, and the movie kind of lampshades this, that she got suckered by a sob story, right? So she's not trying to capture Crackerjack when she sets that trap. She thinks she's setting it up so that the man who lost this important family heirloom, this ring, can ask for it back.
Mm.
And when she realizes that, well, it's not even the cops that are going to get him, it's this ruthless gang of criminals that are going to assassinate him, she really panics and she's very angry at herself for falling for this whole thing.
Fair, but again, even though the crooks make so much fun of her that they repeat the same line twice about how she fell for this.
They repeat it within her hearing, so she gets to learn the lesson.
Twice. Again, I still, if they were going to bother to make this woman ex-Secret Service, they could have made her more clever and the movie would have been better for it.
I agree with you that there could have been some tweaks there that would have made it a little bit more plausible, the whole thing.
Well, not even plausibility, just interest. That's why I said I felt that that character was the weakest thing in the movie.
It is a little bit Crackerjack's fault, too, for not taking her into his confidence. You know, she keeps asking him, are you Crackerjack? I pretty much know you are. Why won't you just tell me and then we can have an open conversation about what's going on, but he won't.
Yeah, but then he does tell her.
No, he doesn't.
He doesn't tell her, but he wants to know what's going on. I guess he doesn't need to know because he already knows, because he already knows everything well in advance. Again, that's a weak plot point where she's, yeah, well, let's talk about it over dinner. You will have dinner with me, right? No.
Yeah, why doesn't he play straight with her, you know? But you're right, he's got it all in hand. He's invincible. It's pretty fun, this character. Now, we should backtrack a little bit and set the stage. We can't count on everyone having seen the movie, although if you're having any trouble, just get in touch with us. We can point you in the right direction. We are on a plane, and we first meet the main character played by Tom Walls. He's trying to interest a rich man in donating to an important hospital fund. And the man is like, no, I can't be bothered with that. There's a daring mid-air heist engineered by some tough-talking American gangsters. They grab these diamonds and then force the plane to the ground, kick everyone off the plane, take off with their spoils. There is a policeman on the plane, and this becomes important. He feels duty-bound to try to interfere even though he's outgunned and outnumbered, and our hero Crackerjack punches him in the face to knock him out, and the policeman thanks him for it later because he was just going to get himself killed. And we find out that these gangsters have no compunctions about killing people. But when the gangsters get to their lair, Crackerjack has beaten them to the jewels, and that's kind of how we are led into the world of this mystery.
Yeah, so he's a one-man welfare state.
That's one of the most amazing things about this movie, right? And a difference from the Hollywood model. He could not have been like this and gotten away with it in a Hollywood movie. Even if the movie would throw sympathy to him because of his objectives, he still would have had to die or go to prison for what he did in this movie.
But I thought that the British welfare state occurred after World War II, as a result of World War II. So why do you think he's allowed to be socialist in his criminal orientation in a British movie?
I don't know enough about the codes that were enforced in Britain at the time. We know that there were censors. I think they were very strict about sexual innuendo and that kind of thing, but apparently did not have a blanket dictate that any crime must be punished.
I thought you meant what he was using the money for wouldn't be allowed.
An American movie might have had the same thing, but he would have had to go to jail for it anyway, because it's against the law.
You think? Even if he was being benevolent?
Yeah. Most likely.
Can you think of an example?
I'd have to really rack my brains, but anyone who's committing crimes in a Hollywood movie has to pay for it.
Not Errol Flynn's Robin Hood.
In a modern context. It's fine if you want to say that England under Prince John was like a rogue state and no laws applied. But it's not the same thing when you've got 1930s England. You know, if this was a contemporary Hollywood film and these robberies were taking place, Crackerjack would be a beloved figure in the movie, but would get shot or something, or be taken off to jail and maybe gotten a light sentence because of his philanthropic pilfering, but there'd be something. He just gets on a plane at the end of this movie and leaves the country with his intended. It is a subject for further investigation. I'm sure there's stuff written on what the British censors allowed and didn't allow in the 1930s. If you're listening out there and you know, please send us some suggestions. Articles, books.
I don't want to read a whole book on it. Just, you know, summarize. Really enjoyed about this movie was its absolute balls out, total lack of caring about quote unquote realism. Craziest moment of this being when Crackerjack is in disguise at that reception, the soiree where he's going to steal the hostess's pearls, and the American gangsters show up and do a musical number before they rob the joint.
Yeah. It was great. That's a highlight. There was, you know, an American act that dressed like gangsters and sing.
But they weren't actual gangsters.
The quartet that was supposed to appear were knocked out and tied up. And the real gangsters performed just as well, apparently. Then take off their masks and start shooting people if they get out of line.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of people who are not what they seem to be in this movie. The bluff aristocratic guy that Lilli Palmer goes to that soiree with on her date turns out to be a member of the gang. So hard times must have hit his estate. We don't really know what's going on there. And Lilli Palmer herself is some kind of minor aristocrat from the continent, but has been a spy and is now living it up in a hotel suite in London, reading in the bathtub.
This character is clearly not supposed to be in her early 20s, more like her mid-30s.
Yeah.
And honestly, I will say this for her, that she plays it like that.
Yeah, she's pretty convincing as a worldly wise woman, I think. She had this affair with Crackerjack in the distant past. I mean, Lilli Palmer herself would have been, what, 14 when this poster came?
That's a little disturbing to contemplate, the last time he fell for her.
So yeah, they have this prehistory, and he had to leave. You get the sense that duty called him to another big heist in another country. country, or the authorities were on to him in Vienna or wherever they were.
Well, he's got this relationship with his secretary.
Yeah, the secretary is very important.
Secretary foiled the romantic relationship, and it's the classic trope of the two men who are in a sexless marriage. The one who's not the lead of the movie has to be discarded so that he can have a heteronormative sexful marriage.
Yeah, he really gets
brutally discarded at the end.
Left at the airport.
This completely loyal and necessary secretary.
Well, you know, if he ever gets back on track with his unofficial wealth redistribution, Lilli Palmer maybe could be his assistant. I mean, she's got the makings of a pretty good coordinator.
He does say not on our honeymoon, so possibly the secretary will, you know, they'll meet up again.
Yeah, they may become a trio.
If that will work, or that might result in no exit.
So a lot of interesting moments along the way. Agree with you in some sense that the Lilli Palmer character is kind of a series of set pieces that don't necessarily all go together seamlessly the way they would if the director was paying more attention. She starts out kind of really madcap, just gets this brain flash in the bathtub that Crackerjack, I think I know him. And that sort of comes and goes. And you see that big light bulb moment at the party where he asks for his characteristic water instead of soda with the drink.
Right, and I keep waiting for this to lead to something, and it still doesn't.
Well, it just leads to something on her face. She registers it. But no, it's never actually referred to.
No, but it doesn't lead to anything in the plot.
Just that it's one more thing that she can tick off to convince her that Crackerjack is Jack.
Sure, but again, never adds up to anything.
And a lot of it does wind up revolving around clever charades that he's able to perform in order to get the best of these rich people. The movie is gleefully indifferent to the fate of the jewels and wealth in question, right? The insurance is going to cover it, and in the meantime, kids are going to be saved from horrible death at the hands of some curable disease. Right after the first diamond heist, we get to see the fruits of his labor. This ward filled with children that are being cared for. They love him.
And he's giving one child, one little girl, the bunny from You Can't Take It With You.
Yeah, looks like exactly the same thing that Mr. Poppins whipped up.
What year is You Can't Take It With You?
Same year.
Yeah.
1938. So another little bit of American film influence, possibly, or maybe it goes the other way around.
No, I don't think so.
The hospital has continuous demands. They want to expand it. No sooner has he gotten those jewels than a doctor says, well, if you could write up another check for $10,000.
Well, he doesn't even say that. He just says,
that's what we need.
We need $10,000. And then Jack offers it.
He's like, yeah, I think I can figure out a way to get that to you.
48 hours. How soon do you need it? I can do it in 48 hours.
I don't have the check on me, but
the doctor is flabbergasted.
I'm sure there's some idiotic rich person in London wearing something that nobody needs to have around their neck that I can grab.
Well, it's the Baroness who tips him off, gives him this next lead. And then the other crazily unrealistic part of it all is that he's getting away with all of these schemes, all of these tricks, even though he's written a bestseller giving away all of his tricks.
I know, it's amazing. He doesn't give a fuck. It's really a great character, actually. I would have liked to have seen a whole series of these.
Yeah, even though this is not a farce, it makes perfect sense to have a farcer play this character.
He's having a great time.
A light charm.
That smile, playing all these different characters, but you've always got that little smile there that helps you to identify him. Even when he's playing the aged butler, he looks pretty much like the butler, except when you look really closely. Oh wait, it's Crackerjack. Some of the tricks are actually pretty fun. If you run into someone and you need to gain their confidence quickly, just make up a story about owing them money and they're not going to turn that down.
It was reminding me of the come on lines in The Lady Eve, just pretending to this man that they've met before, and the man's just being polite even though he knows he's never actually been to this place.
Yeah.
But that's only going to get him so far until he makes the further addition of paying him money back, and then it doesn't matter to the man anymore that he knows they've never met.
No, that fiver makes all the difference, and it adds such an incredible extra layer when you find out that this man is one of the gangsters. He's in on the big robbery, but he needs that fiver. Now, the robbery does seem to go a little bit haywire. The Americans that they imported to do the really dirty work get overly enthusiastic about what they're doing and shoot a guest. This was not supposed to happen. And it becomes a much bigger deal. Crackerjack, if he's implicated, if the police decide that he's part of this gang, well, I mean, he could get the chair.
Well, it's around this time that Lilli Palmer's character basically tries to hand Jack over to the police, but the police officer, still this same guy who was saved by Jack, he won't listen to her. He thinks it's silly. He never lets her get very far with it.
No, but she doesn't say, "I think it's Jack." She says, "It's definitely Crackerjack."
Yes, but I feel like she's warming up to that as her next reveal.
No, I don't think so.
Oh, well, that's what I thought. If she's trying to implicate Crackerjack in this and knows it's Jack, then she's also implicating Jack. See, I never understand this character's motives scene to scene.
She's trying to figure things out. She's talking out loud, maybe in ways that
she shouldn't. To the police!
Yeah, I agree. It's risky.
And I don't feel like she's being directed, or maybe it's the way the character is written, for us to understand exactly what the hell she thinks she's doing in all of these scenes.
No, but where it does come together to some extent is when the crooks run their own little con on her, where they bring in that old guy who says, I know this woman who was in the Secret Service. I think she could do something for us. And he goes and tells her about the ring that was lost. I just want that back. These other jewels and other treasures that are easily replaceable, fine. But this is something that goes to the heart. And she falls for it. And she's dying to get back into the spy game. She comes up with a way to meet Crackerjack. She puts an ad in the paper.
He uses the Crime Unlimited method of communication here.
He does. It's pretty cool. So she's been involved in a few of these.
In a museum full of masks from British Imperial Enterprise.
He knows that this is possibly a trap. His secretary is sure it's a trap, and of course it is. And he's like, well, if it is, I'll figure a way out. Don't worry about it. He responds to the ad in the paper and has a whole list of requirements for the person to signal their identity upon meeting with the representative of Crackerjack, and she complies, and she's taken to the secret lair, and they have their whole conversation. He's a disembodied voice. Those scenes are neat. I liked it. He has these other operatives. Again, that's something that could be developed. You know, it's kind of borrowing a little bit from The Shadow, even. Shadow's always got some cabbies working for him and other random people that he's saved in the past, and they may not even know who he is. Maybe they do, but they will run errands and be the go-between.
Honestly, though, it's not like this was a genius plot of any kind. The only reason you'd want to do this as a series is if you had the same actor.
Well, yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. This should have been a series, the Crackerjack series. On the other hand, that might have tied Lilli Palmer up for a long time in more confusing iterations of her Baroness, so maybe not. I'm interested to see some other Tom Walls movies, and apparently he made a lot, right?
Yeah, well, he kept going, yeah. He also directed.
A Renaissance man.
To give you an idea of how quickly made this movie must have been, though, someone in our Discord group was pointing out repetition of a particular page of a book in Son of Dracula.
Yeah.
Apparently they just, to save on filming, they just kept showing the same page of this book.
Do we have something like that in Crackerjack?
Oh yeah, I noticed at the beginning when they were doing the newspaper stories about Crackerjack. Two of the newspaper stories were repeated.
Okay. If it's old papers once, just print the whole thing again. It's always the same story, Crackerjack victorious. It's really interesting, too, that it's never really a matter of the police catching up with him. It's just the fact that this group of transplanted American gangsters are trying to make a name for themselves in Britain, and every time they think they've made a big score, they wind up with a handful of paste jewelry. So they're the ones that set out to bring him down, and it does cause him some trouble here. I mean, he does have to run away at the end. And it's not exactly certain what's going to happen. All of these guys know who he is. They're accusing him, presumably, so he's probably going to have to stay out of the UK from now on, unless the police just say, oh, you guys are not trustworthy.
Do they know who he is?
They do.
There's someone there who knows him.
The guy's from the plane. Yeah, he's identified, right? Because it all comes out that it's the same guy that's been giving money to hospitals, etc.
All right. Because I know they've seen his face, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they have identified him.
No, they have. They have. Are they going to be believed? Are the police just going to look the other way?
Only in comic books, as soon as you take the mask off, is the superhero destroyed forever.
Because usually people don't know who that is anyways.
Well, yeah. Well, in this case, certainly.
Well, there you're just like Steve Ditko. That was what he really wanted for the Green Goblin. He was finally going to be unmasked, and it was going to be some guy nobody ever heard of. And it was going to be like, there you go. But Stan Lee wanted it to be someone who was already in the cast, and it would be a shocking reveal. Mm. Harry Osborn's dad.
Just like David Lynch's thinking in Twin Peaks.
Right. Steve Ditko. And David Lynch.
It's always a dad reveal. Well, everyone should know that by now.
This was a fun double feature, I thought. These are not amazing opportunities for Lilli Palmer, but she is second billed in both of them. She's moving up the ranks, clearly.
She's being groomed for stardom.
That's right. She was impatient. She thought these movies are forgettable at best. She was doing some work on the stage as well, which she was more interested in at the time in the 1930s.
Well, certainly what she had to do in these movies was forgettable.
Yeah, but I'm enjoying the early phases of Lilli's career, and I think it's just going to get better and better from here.
Yeah, I feel like, particularly if Crackerjack is any indication, that I don't know if British film of this period is more heedless of realism, or if it's just the fact that these are B-movies and I don't watch that many American B-movies, although we are seeing more of them doing our studios year by year. I guess it's not any more insane than, what was that?
The Mad Doctor of Market Street.
The Mad Doctor, yeah, you knew. That was a mind read. Oh, and I love that movie, The Mad Doctor of Market Street. That was great.
Well, we'll see if we get one like that before we're into the prestige era of Lilli's career.
Son of Dracula was pretty good, too. The other thing I found out that I don't think I knew about before, so Crackerjack was made by Gainsborough Pictures. Have you heard of the Gainsborough melodramas?
I don't think so. Not by name, anyway.
So these were 1940s melodramas that were insanely popular with audiences, particularly with women during the war era when they made up the primary cinema-going audience.
What are some of the titles? I might have seen some.
Some of them were costume melodramas. The Seventh Veil with James Mason. That's not one of them, but it's a very famous British melodrama that was compared to the Gainsborough melodramas or influenced by them. James Mason was in a lot of these Gainsborough melodramas. I guess that's how he rose to stardom.
What are some of the titles?
Apparently they were mostly based on recent popular books by female novelists. Prominent titles included The Man in Grey, Madonna of the Seven Moons, Fanny by Gaslight, The Wicked Lady, and Caravan.
Have not seen any of those. Maybe this is a special subject.
This is what I'm saying. Starring the likes of Margaret Lockwood, James Mason, Stuart Granger, and Patricia Rock.
I love Margaret Lockwood. She's in Lady Vanishes, but later in her career, I think she played a lot of villains.
These movies were absolutely trash at the time, including by the people who starred in them, but like it seems like they have taken longer to be rehabilitated. Maybe British feminists weren't as focused on film as American feminists, or there wasn't a feminist film studies contingent in England. I don't know, but it seems that they've taken longer to be rehabilitated than 1940s women's picture noirs, which are like among my very favorite studio era Hollywood genres.
Well, I think definitely something to put on the list. The Gainsborough melodramas, a special subject, maybe 2039, 2040.
Yep.
Thereabouts.
I think so.
Another thing I'm going to be watching for, when does Lilli stop dyeing her hair blonde? Next time on the podcast, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, RKO 1944. We'll be discussing Passport to Destiny and None But the Lonely Heart, directed by Clifford Odets. The famous Cockney tragedy with Cary Grant.
Yeah, I saw it when I was young. Wasn't crazy about it. We'll see how I feel this time. What's Passport to Destiny?
I don't know.
Okay, well, we'll find out. There was some reason we chose it, but we'll figure that out next week.
Join us then.